titled hashtag solution carriers. Because I look at the world we live in and there's so much happening and so many unanswered questions. Just to bring some context, I'll just take two scriptures. 2 Timothy chapter 3, take the first five verses, and I'll read from the New King James Version. It says, "But know this, that in the last days perilous times will come. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying its power. And from such people," it says, "turn away." Second scripture I want to look at is Isaiah 60, but I want to look at it from the Amplified Version. I'm taking the first three verses. The Amplified Version says, we know the King James Version. It says, "Arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you." But I like the Amplified because it truly amplifies it. It says, "Arise from the depression and prostration in which circumstances have kept you. Rise to a new life. Shine and be radiant with the glory of the Lord, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, darkness shall cover the earth, and dense darkness all peoples. But the Lord shall arise upon you, O Jerusalem, and his glory shall be seen on you. And nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising." I like to read the Message Version as well. It says, "Get out of bed, Jerusalem. Wake up. Put your face in the sunlight. God's bright glory has risen for you. And the whole earth is wrapped in darkness. All people sunk in deep darkness. But God rises on you. And his sunrise glory breaks over you. Nations will come to your light. And kings to your sunburst brightness." And so this is just to paint a picture of, for me, it's scriptures that really paint a picture of where the world is today. And if you look the world over, there's almost no nation that is spared of the problems and the challenges we see around. Every day, like a friend of ours said, you don't need to watch an action movie anymore. Just turn on CNN. And all you see is action all over the place. Yesterday, we had one action movie playing out in Munich. The week before, we had the other one in Baton Rouge and Dallas. And every day, there's a new one, Turkey. I never thought I would see tanks facing people after Tiananmen Square in China. Then I see it in Turkey happening. And I'm like, what's going on? And so we see that right now, the world is in a period of seeming confusion, uncertainty, and darkness. It's characterized by a lot of upheaval and turmoil. Economic, political, religious, all kinds of things are happening all over the world. And at the end of the day, nobody has an answer to what's happening. Nobody knows what to do and how things will play out. I look to the US, and if you ask anybody who's going to win the election, nobody can say. If you ask anyone a year ago who would win the Republican nomination, nobody would have given Trump a chance. But there he is. He's the candidate for the Republican Party. Everything has spiked. Economies are shot to pieces. The political scene is just changing everywhere. And sometimes you sit down and reflect and ask, what should be done? In every nation, people are asking questions. Nobody knows what to do. And here we are faced with all manner of recession, all kinds of economic issues, challenges, trials, problems. Nobody seems to be spared. And nobody seems to know what to do. But if we look at 1 Chronicles chapter 12, in reflecting, there are times you get some clarity from God as to what needs to be done, what needs to happen. In 1 Chronicles chapter 12, verse 32. It says, of the sons of Issachar, who had understanding of the times, to know what Israel ought to do. It says their chiefs were 200 and all their brethren were at their command. And at a time like this, when there's confusion, God needs people like those guys, the sons of Issachar. It says there were men who understood the times and they knew what Israel ought to do. At this time, all over the world, God needs people who understand the times, who can read the times. That things are not going well doesn't mean God is not alive. It's how you can find God in the midst of all that's happening and find direction and follow it. Because in the midst of the chaos, and why I love that scripture in the Isaiah 16 Amplified, it says the situation of prostration and depression. It says circumstances have kept you in that position, but it says you need to arise from that position and then the glory comes upon you. And it's not that someone picks you up. You rise up yourself in the midst of that situation and you see God come upon you. And that's what is needed in this time and in this age. Because globally, everybody is confused. That same scripture says, darkness covers the earth and gross darkness the people. You don't need to look far. There's so much happening every day. Every day, nations or parliaments pass laws that just beat the imagination. If it's not same-sex marriage, it's bestiality coming into legal. Some countries legalize prostitution, and you're asking, what's going on here? But God looks for people who, in the midst of that darkness, can seek out what is the right path and the way to go. And those are the people that are needed at a time like this. The question many people always ask is, I can't do anything. I really don't have, there's not much I can do. I don't have access to the parliament or the people in government. I can't really make laws. I can't influence things. But I beg to differ. Because in Ezekiel, it says that God sought a man, one man, to stand in the gap concerning the nation and that he would turn his wrath away from that land. But he says, I found none. That you are not able to speak to the authorities doesn't mean you don't have a voice. Recently, I've been reading the book of Ezekiel a lot. And one thing that struck me was in, I think it's Ezekiel 30. God said to Ezekiel, it says in the 10th year of the captivity of King Jehoiakim, he said to Ezekiel, he says, raise a proclamation against Egypt and bring my judgment against them, that I am going to wipe Egypt out of this, on this earth. And it was about 16, 17 years later that he now said, speak again and say, the king of Babylon should go and do my bidding. And that's when Egypt was wiped out. And he said specifically that Egypt will be wiped out, it will rise again, but it will never be a major nation anymore. And it came to pass. He didn't go to the parliament or he didn't go to the king of Egypt and tell him this was going to happen. He just spoke it into the air. We have a power that we don't understand. That God can cause you to decree things and they will be established. But all of us are so caught in the issues around us that we're worried about how things will turn out. We are meant to be speaking at this time. We need to hear God and speak at this time. Now, I just want to take a character in the Bible that speaks to me about what I'm talking about, and that is the character of Joseph. If we look at Genesis 45, verses 3 to 8, we know the story of Joseph. He was destined to be great, sold by his brothers into slavery because they hated him. He came into the house of Potiphar. He excelled in that house. He was a trusted slave, which is an anomaly. The man just ceded all his investments to Joseph, a slave, which was unheard of. And he prospered his master. But because of trumped up charges, he was put in prison. and things went from bad to worse. But in prison, he was still there, taking care of the prisoners. He took charge of everything, and he was blessed. And one thing that strikes me through his stories, it always said, and God was with him. And God was with Joseph all through the trials he had. And then one day, Pharaoh, who was known as the God of Egypt, has a problem and looks to a man to solve his problem. And if you do anything about the culture of Egypt, Pharaoh was the sun god, and nobody could speak to him. And he had a problem, and they said there was a Jew. The Jews were an abomination to the Egyptians. And so he brought him, and he came and solved the problem. And he said, none will be above you, except in this land, you will be next to me. And so Joseph became, as it were, the prime minister of Egypt. And he had lain over all the resources of Egypt. And he had prophesied there would be a famine, and they would store up grain for the time of famine. And they became the distributor for the end time in the whole world at that point. Now, this is where we pick the story up, where his brothers came and fulfilled the prophecy where they would bow to him. He came to buy grain. And this is where he now reveals himself to his brothers. So if we take it from verse 3, it says, Genesis 45, 3 to 8. Then Joseph said to his brothers, I am Joseph. Does my father still live? It says, but his brothers could not answer him, for they were dismayed in his presence. And Joseph said to his brothers, please come near to me. So they came near. Then he said, I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into Egypt. But now do not therefore be grieved or angry with yourselves, because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For these 2 years, the famine has been in the land, and there are still 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvesting. And God sent me before you to preserve a posterity for you in the earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. So now it was not you who sent me here, but God. And he has made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of all his house and a ruler throughout all the land of Egypt. And what for me is very striking about this is Joseph was done bad by his brothers. They treated him very badly, very shabbily. If I was Joseph, I know I don't think I could forgive them that easy. But what jumps out at me from this scripture is he says, it wasn't you, it was God. And I mean, what kind of reaction is that? They put him through a lifetime of about 13 years of hell. And now he's in a position to literally destroy them. He comes and says, it wasn't you, but God. And so for me, what comes out of this is that God, Joseph could discern his purpose in life from God's standpoint, not from his personal situation. Many of us, without a doubt, are going through really trying times. And it's easy to blame the next person or the system or the country or the economy or your job, your whatever. But step back and check with God, what exactly is going on? What exactly am I meant to be doing at this time? Because throughout his stay in Egypt, before he became prime minister, things were not good for him. But it kept saying, and God was with Joseph. And God was with Joseph. Till he came to the point where he now became prime minister. We need to, at this time, begin to step back and check with God, what is he doing in our environment, our families, our cities, our nations, and what role am I meant to play? He knew he was going to be great. He knew his family would bow to him, but he didn't know in what way. And all the years he was there, he probably would have been thinking, I'm so far away from this dream coming to reality. But God is not a God of confusion. He's a God of purpose, a God of order, a God of fulfillment. That season for Joseph was a time of refining and incubating, building up what God wanted to do. The things he went through were necessary for him to come out. Let me pick the scripture in Psalm 105. to help understand what Joseph went through and what he realized. Because you ask yourself, how can God put him through all that for what he wants to do? It doesn't make sense. But if we look at Psalm 105, and we take it from verse 16, it says, "Moreover, he, God, called for a famine in the land, and he destroyed all the provision of bread. And he sent a man before them, Joseph, who was sold as a slave. And since they hurt his feet with fetters, he was laid in irons until the time that his word came to pass. And the word of the Lord tested him. And the king sent and released him. The ruler of the people let him go free. He made him the lord of his house and the ruler of all his possessions, to bind his princes at his pleasure and teach his elders wisdom." And so you see, this checks out with what Joseph came to understand. He understood that it's not about the suffering I'm going through, it's about the end. God sent him to preserve Israel. And he understood his task. So he could go through what he was going through with some sense of understanding, knowing that there's a certain outcome. In the same vein, Christ died and gave a victory which we are meant to enforce. You're not meant to be moved by the situations around you. You're meant to be moved by what is the end game and how am I meant to bring it to pass. What you're going through is irrelevant in the scheme of things. When I look at the story of Job, what jumps at me is God wasn't interested in his possessions. He wasn't interested in his health. He was interested in his soul. So he could allow Satan to touch his wealth, touch his soul, his body, but not his soul. And his reaction is one thing that challenges me. He says, "The Lord gives, the Lord takes. Blessed is the name of the Lord." When you come to that realization of what your purpose in God is, then you can walk and stand and do all he needs to do. And we need to come. And I love the prophecy that came forth. That really is what God is. He's calling people to his heart. That enough of all the games, enough of all the... Idolatry is not about worshiping another God. It's about worshiping anything other than God. So it might be your job. It might be your wife, your child, your fancy car. It could be anything. It might not be a religion. It's just a lack of worship of God. Now, another person in scripture who helps, kind of symbolizes this, is the character of David. If you know the story of Goliath, David and Goliath in 1 Samuel 17. I'm not going to go there. But we know that Goliath was the champion of the Philistines and he terrorized Israel and said, "Who can come and fight me?" For 40 days. It says every time he would come out, everyone would run and scamper to safety because they were afraid. And then David, a mere boy of about 17, he's not a soldier, he's never been a warrior. He just comes to bring food to his brothers who are in the army. And he hears Goliath and says, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine who is challenging the armies of God?" And he says, "He's challenging, nobody is even..." He says, I'll take him on." And his brothers are like, "You're a very foolish boy. How can you go and take him on? You've never fought. You don't know anything about war. You're a proud little runt." And David said, "No, I mean, he's challenging God." Long story short, he goes out there without weapons, with a sling, 5 stones, but he goes in the name of the Lord. Goliath comes and says, "Today I will cut your head off." He says, "You come against me with sword and spear." He says, "I come against you in the name of the Lord, and today I will cut your head off." I mean, for him to say that, he knew he was going to get a sword, but he didn't have a sword. So he obviously knew he was going to take Goliath out and use his sword, cut his head off, and move on. These two characters epitomize for me what God is calling his people to at this time. There are a lot of Goliaths in the world today that are terrorizing our nations, our communities, our families. And he needs Davids and Josephs to rise up and stand for him, decree things, and they will be established. Now, if we look at Matthew 16, to lock it down, Matthew 16, verse 18-19, scripture we know very well. When Jesus asked Peter or his disciples, "Who do men say I am?" And Peter responded and says, "You are the Christ, the Messiah." And he says, "Flesh and blood did not reveal that to you, but my heavenly Father." And then he goes on to say, "And also I say to you that you are Peter." Can I have the Amplified Version? I just want to do a bit of Bible study here. The Amplified Version. If you know anything about the Bible, most times we read King James was a translation done from the New Testament was written in Greek and the Old Testament was written in Hebrew. So everything we read is a translation. So many times a translation is open to a person's quirkiness in terms of what he brings out. And if you know anything about the King James Version, it was sponsored by King James at the time, who was the King of England. And the Church of England was subject to the monarch as the ruler. So he gave them specific instructions about how there are certain things they should interpret in certain ways. And I need to say this to bring out certain things in this scripture. It says in Amplified, it says, "I tell you, you are Peter." The word Peter in Greek is Petros, which means a large piece of rock. It says, "And on this rock," this time the word is Petra, "a huge rock that is like Gibraltar, I will build my church. And the gates of Hades, the power of infernal region, shall not overpower it or be strong to its detriment or hold out against it." We'll pause there. Now, most people say that Peter was the first pope of the church, and that the scripture says that Christ built the church on him. Because it says, if you read the other versions, it just says, "You are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church." So people translate that to mean that on Peter, who was the rock. That's why I tried to use the Amplified to make the distinction between Petra and Petros. It was not on Petros that he built the church. It was on Petra, which is the huge rock of Revelation. Now, the other thing is, it says, "I will build my church." The original Greek word for church there is ecclesia. Now, ecclesia was translated to church, which means a place of worship where we come to. But the ecclesia in the Greek language speaks of a council of, like your senate, your parliament, a group of people who make decisions. That is God's mind about what the church should be. Not a place where we come to worship and feel good and we have nice worship, go home feeling light and nice. It is a place where you come together and make decisions about things. So we need to change our mindset. So I love the prophecy that came forth. It's not about Sunday. It's about you have your fire. And when you come on Sunday, you come together and make a big fire. You make declarations that stand. So you don't wait till Sunday to come, then you come and enjoy the worship, hear a word, and go feeling, I heard a good word. No, you come as the word. Join others, make decrees, proclamations, and see things happen. That's what church is in God's mind. So the King James did a disservice in translating it as church. Because what we see is church is a place we come to feel good, dress up nicely. It's a place where you come as a ranking official amongst a group of people and make decrees, make laws. Parliament in every country is the highest ruling body in terms of lawmaking. That's what we are meant to be as church. I needed to make this distinction because when you understand what church is and what you're doing here, then you don't worry about the issues around you. You come together and you see some law that the parliament is about to make, and you say, "In the name of Jesus, we stand and decree here today that that shall not stand." And it will happen because you understand. It says, "When two or three gather in my name and they agree as touching anything, they have what they say." When you understand the potency and the power that is in you, then you decree things and they are established. So any law, we can decide today that as a church, as an ecclesia, we desire that so-so person should win the American election. I'm not naming names, so It's up to you what you want. And we sit down and stand on the word of God and say, Lord, this is what we decree. And it will happen. If you read, you know, I love to read about men of God who have passed. There's a man called John Knox. He was a Scottish clergyman. The Queen of England and Scotland then, Mary, said there's nothing that terrifies her as John Knox on his knees. Because when he prayed and spoke, it happened. That's the Queen. And the Queen had the power to put him to death. But she couldn't. In fact, she was removed, that Queen. She was removed. We have a power to decree things and they will be established. But do you know the power you have? Also, I want to wrap up with a few things about characteristics of who solution carriers should be. Because when you know that you are a solution to a problem, then you know what you need to do. First off, God does not need people who've done Bible college, who are clergy for 20 years. He uses everyday, regular people who don't even have any, who haven't even gone to Bible college. He can use anybody. But what he wants are people who have an absolute trust in him. And coming to that place is not easy. Trust me. You need to be one who seeks him with your whole heart. You know, in Hebrews 6 and 11, it says, he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. He didn't say those who seek him, those who diligently. Diligence implies labor, effort, in spite of, you know, if your children play hide and seek. So he's always hiding and waiting for you to look. Job said something, I think it was in Job 40, that I sought the Lord on the right hand where he usually is. He wasn't there. I looked on the left. He wasn't there. I looked all around. He says, I didn't know he was hiding. He says, but whatever happens, I know I will come out as gold. He had such an unshakable faith and confidence in God. He says, I can't find him in my situation, but I know that I will come out purified, refined like gold. He needs people who will have an absolute trust. Now, I say something that if you profess a faith, that faith must be tested. So you can't just say, I believe this for the sake of saying it. It has to be. How else will we know you if you don't, if we have to test it? So in Abraham's case, Abraham said, I believe God. And God said, give me your beloved son, the one whom you love. And Abraham, without hesitation, did that. And that's why the Bible says it was counted unto him for righteousness. And God, after that, said, in blessing, I will bless you. And he took a covenant. He said, this one oath on himself, on something that could not be shaken. God needs people who seek him with all their heart, in spite of what you've gone through. Another thing is, people who are broken are the people God can work with. And trials are the things that break you. So if you're going through a hard time, bear it with a smile. And just seek God for his counsel and direction through it. Because he didn't say if, Isaiah 43 says, when you go through the fire, the waters, they won't drown you or burn you. He didn't say if or maybe. He says when, of a certainty. People that God uses, most times they go through things. To prune them, like John 15 talks about pruning the branches that are fruitful, that they might be more fruitful. I mean, it stands to logic that if you're up one day, you will be down one day. You can never be up forever. It's not possible. Life is full of ups, downs. That's what life is meant to be. It's not meant to be all fun and games throughout. You will have down times. The second thing, God looks for people who have integrity. And integrity is so lacking in today's world, especially amongst Christians. In Psalm 15 or 16, it says, where it says, who shall ascend unto the holy hill of God? It says, he that will swear even to his own hurt and keep a promise. That's the one God looks to. If you know the story of Joshua, in the time of the occupation, when the Israelites were coming out and occupying the land, it says, God said, do not make a covenant with the people of Gibeah or with any people from the land. And the Gibeonites came and tricked them. And when they found out, God said, you must fulfill that covenant, even though it was wrong, because he holds integrity. And you will find in years to come, in the time of David, Saul killed the Gibeonites. And there was a famine in the land that wiped out quite a few Israelites. And David inquired of God and found out that that was it. And went to the Gibeonites and asked, what can we do? They said, we don't want anybody else to die. Just 10 males from the house of Saul should be killed. And the plague was stayed. God held that covenant, even though it was wrongly founded, many hundred years later. God holds integrity to heart. And if you're going to be one person that God can use, you have to stand in the place of integrity. He says, let your yea be yea and your amen, or your nay be nay. The third thing, he looks for people who are selfless. So it's not about you. So whatever you're going through is totally irrelevant in the scheme of things right now. The people who, if you interview any hero, he didn't set out to be a hero. The circumstance just evoked a reaction from him. And his first thought at the time was to save his group or his nation or whatever, not to be a hero. I don't know of any. I've listened to many heroes who I interviewed, and none of them sets out to be a hero. They just do what they do because they're thinking of the good of the nation, the land, whatever, the sovereignty of wherever they are. Those are the kinds of people God looks for. If you're a selfish person and think of yourself first, you have a long way to go. Probably he will load some more trials on you to shake those things off, like Joseph. And the final thing is, he looks for people who are faithful. One thing I love about Joseph is he was faithful through every situation. It didn't matter whether he was cheated, whether he was maligned. All he did was just stay faithful to what he was called to do. Search your heart. Are you faithful? Can God call you faithful? In your office, in wherever you find yourself, are you faithful? This morning, I just want us to pray a bit.